Today, Dr. Anaita Udwadia is going to speak about somatic illnesses in children. I invite Dr. Udwadia on the stage.
I had a depressing feel that I treated, but the talk that happened before me was so upsetting and so disturbing. I think as a parent, as an adult in all forms, it was honestly very disturbing. So I think mine now sounds much simpler and lighter given the note we've just completed. So what we're going to start is today is somatic illnesses. Okay, now what is somatic? Somatic means working with the physical state, not so much the mental state. So it is when you get a physical ailment or you get a physical problem due to an underlying mental thing, which is either anxiety, worry, fear, etc. But it manifests itself as a physical problem. Okay, so when you look at it, it's a syndrome, it's a symptom known as somatoform, manifests as a physical symptom, an illness or even an injury, which cannot be explained medically. But cannot be explained medically very often is not something that a parent or another child or a teacher is aware of. So invariably it gets referred to the physician, and then the physician has to decide whether this is really a medical condition or this is not a medical condition. So what do we have? You have a physical symptom which cannot be explained either by a physical or by a mental disorder. Then the person has excessive thoughts about it, and the child or the adult keeps thinking about it. What is this problem I have? Why do I have this problem? That eventually leads to anxiety. This thing is not going. It's happening again and again. Mommy, do something. Why is it not going? Then the thought of the symptom playing in your mind, it starts affecting your day life. It starts affecting your home life, your school life, your social interaction, etc. And then you start manifesting it in the form of a pain, and my hip is paining or my leg is paining and I can't walk and it's hurting. And that eventually is a somatoform disorder. So it's not something that happens overnight. It's something that's been there for some time. So if a child is manifesting with a somatoform disorder, indicates that the child is being under a certain degree of stress for a period of time before he's actually coming to you. So where do you get these somatoform disorders? The commonest one is stomachache. Okay, my stomach is paining, and that stomachache comes just before we have to go to school, or just when it's time to go to bed, or when the exam day is there that day, or we don't know but the teacher yelled at him in class, and then the next day the stomach starts paining and we don't want to go on the bus because someone bullies us. So all these symptoms will start manifesting at situations which are stressful situations. Now, as a parent, most parents will realize within a period of time that, listen, this symptom is coming regularly at a certain period or with a certain event, or to avoid a certain thing. More important is to avoid a certain thing, and the parent will realize and work on it. But how to work on it, we'll come to down the line. But some of these things are not so simple as just pain in the stomach. Okay, some children actually run to the loo all the time. They actually get a diarrhea. You get an irritable bowel where the stress is so much that you can't contain and you run to the toilet. So you get irritable bowel, you can get seizures or fits, which is really what I see on an average as a neurologist. You can get chest pain, which is more a feature of older people because they're aware that chest pain means heart attack, means people will run to me and look at me a little more carefully. Pulmonology, chronic inflammatory, chest-related problems, and in gynecs, you can also have chronic pelvic pain. So why does it occur? There are multiple reasons that it occurs. We have different dimensions at which we are functioning. So one is on a biological dimension. Some people have a lower threshold for pain. Some people have a lower threshold for anxiety. You've got a past history of an injury which had this much pain. So you have the memory and the image of what actually happened. You have the memory of all the attention and the stuff that happened with it. Some are very sensitive as people. Emotionally as well as physically. The socio-cultural dimensions, you have grandparents who are giving you that much attention and moving circles around you all the time. You have someone in the family who has a problem, so you've watched what happens to that person. So you know exactly what a seizure is supposed to look like. So having the knowledge of a medical condition becomes easier to perform that medical or do that thing accordingly. you're preoccupied with yourself. My stomach is not well. This is not happening well for me. That is not happening well for me. So you get a preoccupation with your health and your ailments which are there. Your negative thought processing, and then there's a whole load of social dimensions which is there. Interaction with peers, interaction with teachers, interaction with parents, interaction in the social sphere all around you. So all that put together, when you are unable to cope with these different situations, it manifests in a different form. Sorry. So is it common? It's quite common. If you look at it, 10 to 15% of children will have some form of somatoform disorder. That's a huge percentage. That's one out of every 10 children will have some form of somatoform disorder. 11 to 21 young adults, so the adolescent is the most vulnerable person. 10 to 20% even in middle age, and as you grow older, it's less, 1.5 to 13%. So what are the different forms that it can come out? It can come out as an illness anxiety disorder. That is, I am just obsessed that I'm going to be ill. So we have hypochondriacs. You know, you use loosely say, oh, don't be a hypochondriac. What does it mean? That I'm persistently thinking something wrong is going to happen with my health. Oh God, there's a virus. I'm sure I'll be sick tomorrow as well. Okay, you are coughing. Aray, don't give it to me. Otherwise, I'll be sick for sure tomorrow. You get it? So there are always those who only see the fact that they are going to fall sick in the next few days, and that is going to disrupt their life, and that it's going to make they are going to go through hardship for it. So somatic disorders, where the anxiety actually manifests in the form of pain over a chronic anxiety. Conversion disorders, where you actually have a neurological thing and then it gets converted, we'll come to that. Then psychological factors affecting, I am sick already, I have asthma, but I think about it the whole time, and we know that stress can make it worse. I have some condition, but if I sit and think and I worry and I worry and I worry and I worry about it, the anxiety of that actually makes my symptoms worse. Okay, and factitious disorders, where I make up something knowledgeably, knowing that I'm making it up, so that I get some benefit. That's totally different. Somatoform and conversion disorders, you have to realize, is not totally with the knowledge of the child or the person. A factitious disorder is, I'm telling you, I don't want to go for the talk today. Oh, my throat is paining. I can't talk today. You get it? I'm actually making it up to try and avoid it. By somatoform, it gets transformed over a chronic period of time so that I feel a pain. I actually feel a pain over here, but I'm not connecting that this pain is because of my anxiety, which is building up on something else that was there before. Okay, so you don't say you're faking it, or you don't say you're acting out or any of that. So what is conversion? Basically, you have either some sort of a neurological concern. In my case, it's neurological, gastrointestinal, etc., etc. You have an acute onset in a response to a stressor. So the most typical thing that we see are what we call pseudo-seizures. What are pseudo-seizures? Pseudo means not true, and seizure means a fit or a seizure. So you cannot say something is pseudo unless you have worked him up totally and are 100% sure this is not a real event. So that is where, as a medical professional, you come in, that you do not take anything. Though the history sounds that this is not real, this is not true, you never take it lightly unless you have proved otherwise. Okay, so it is always for us a diagnosis of exclusion. That means I have to exclude all the causes that can actually cause these sort of symptoms, even though they may not be classical or perfect. And then when I'm sure that I'm looking at something else, I can say that this might be a pseudo-fit. So very often it exists with the true thing. So a child actually has something. So he has seizures or he has fits. And he has seen the attention he gets and the whole family running around him and all the escapism that he can get. He doesn't have to do this. He doesn't have to study if he doesn't want. Nobody shouts at him anymore. Nobody corrects him, lets him eat what he wants. He sleeps till whatever time because everyone is scared that kuch bolega, usko to akri aa jayegi. You get it? And slowly, slowly that anxiety about this thing I have, and then we start getting events which are not real. So there we have the real ones and the not real ones. Becomes very difficult for us to differentiate. Okay? So that's when you have, and some of them are easier to treat, some are not so easy. Somatic symptom disorder, including pain disorder, is what we've discussed, where you have excessive thoughts, feelings, behaviors related to the symptoms. It's disproportionate and it's persistently there in your mind. There's a very high level of anxiety in these children, and a lot of your time and energy gets devoted to thinking only about this problem that you have, which nobody seems to be able to solve. I've gone to one doctor, I've gone to two doctors, they've given me two medicines, four medicines, six medicines, and nothing is happening. It's not going away. You start ruminating again. Have I got something more serious? Is there something that my parents are not telling me? Is there something that I don't know about? And then your mind just keeps playing and you start going on and on. Okay, and usually it is something which has been there for more than 6 months in duration. So you have illness anxiety disorder. This is what we describe, where you have somatic symptoms are absent. You don't actually have any symptoms or things, but you keep thinking you're going to fall sick. You keep thinking something is going to happen. I need to go and get this body checked out totally because I'm sure I will find something inside. Or I'm sure there's some cancer growing somewhere in my body. So there will be those who go for checkups regularly again and again because they are convinced that something is going to be amiss. Okay, so again, it's using up or the anxiety inside that my body is going to be sick. But this is more so in adults. Psychological factors affecting them. Okay, usually if you have an underlying medical condition, if you have any of these high risk factors that we've discussed already, there's an anxiety, which is, this is what I said, if I already have an asthma and I keep thinking about my asthma, I'm going to start breathing more heavily every time I climb three steps because it's my asthma which is making me panic. Oh, it's my heart disease which is making me feel so uncomfortable. Okay, so the more you think of it, psychologically, the thing gets exacerbated. So how do we diagnose this? Honestly, for us, sometimes, in spite of being specialists in a field, it is quite tough. Okay, sometimes it's very easy. Okay, sometimes it's just clear. Like if it's a seizure and I know it has both sides head, it never can be a seizure. Simple. So we have certain guidelines which tell us, so if you see both side involvement, if you see the hips going up and down, if you see anything, we have certain criteria. The minute you see it, you know this is not a true event, you don't have to worry, but you still have to treat it as if it were a serious thing that we'll come to down the line. But for us, it becomes easy to accept it. But sometimes even we are stuck. So when we are stuck, what we do is we do video EEGs, we ask for parents to take video clippings of what it is. We try to actually see what is happening, because when you see it, it's much easier to understand than if you hear someone describing it to you. Okay, so we'll go through two cases down the line, you'll get an idea. But then very often you'll start with one and then you ask the history and say, any other problem? And then he'll say, yes, you know, my head also pains very often. Every day I get this headache in the evening. I say, does anything else pain you? Does your legs pain in the evening? Yes, my legs also pain in the evening, and mommy has to press it every day and massage my feet. So now I've got three system involvements. I've got the so-called jerks that are there. I've got this chronic headache, which is there. I've got chronic leg pain, which is there. And slowly you get it out from the child as to what it is. So very often if you're sitting, it's a very characteristic picture you see. Very anxious parents. You are most likely the fourth doctor, the fifth doctor, or the seventh doctor that they are coming to. And the first thing they tell you is, you know, every doctor I've gone to, nothing they've given us has helped. My child is suffering so much. And, you know, we've tried every medicine that is there and they've changed him from one, two, three, four medicines with no difference. In fact, it's becoming worse over a period of time. Okay, and then the child will pipe in somewhere in the middle where normally they would just sit and listen to their parents talk. The child will pipe in someone and say, no, and you know, it hurts so badly. And then you ask him always, describe how it hurts. There won't be, when you're describing it today, it'll be more this side, today it'll be more that side, today it is more spreading everywhere. So automatically you get a feel that the child is also anxious, mom and dad are anxious. They're doing so many tests, they're spending so much money, the child is missing so much school because of this, and they're all the time investigating him, which to the child is like, I've got something really serious, you know, and the doctor can't find what I have, and my parents are so worried. So you start beginning to believe, and you know, this keeps getting perpetuated over time. So what are the clues? The commonest age that this happens is adolescence, and more so girls than in boys. Okay, I think that's we all know that. It's more so, it's not that it doesn't happen in boys, but it's more so in girls than in boys. You have any history of an adverse childhood event. So if something has happened in your childhood which has left you with a hurt or an emotional or a psychological damage, very often that pain, that anxiety gets transferred into a manifestation like this. Okay, they have personality traits where they have people who find it difficult to express themselves. So, you know, you'll have the kid who'll talk everything, and then the kid who won't say much, can't tell you, mommy, I'm in pain, can't tell you I'm hurting, I'm sad inside, I'm feeling bad for this one or that one. So if you can't express your emotions, it gets internalized over a period of time. So if you have cognitive or intellectual concerns as well, then you can have, if you've had history of seizures, but very often if you see type of jerkings, but they don't lose consciousness, so any of those are little giveaways that this is not there. Small things that when you have seizures, your eyes are always open, never closed. Commonest thing, they'll close their eyes tight and then they'll jerk. So straight away, you know, this is not a seizure. Okay, so little giveaways that we have. And speech gets affected in some of them. Swallowing gets affected. Behavioral, they have unconventional behavior during the history. So when they're talking to you, you'll find that their behavior is either too precocious for a child that age, or it's not normal for what should be happening. Emotional processing problems are there, recent life stressors, remote life stressors, family dynamics. Very often family dynamics. I know we come from a very united, the Indian family has great qualities to it. It's amazing because we are so united, we are so into each other's lives. But when you become an adolescent, many parents don't realize where they have to step back and where they have to let the child grow on their own. So this continuous pressure on them and the academic pressure is just killing. And many of them can't express it to you. Commonest thing you see is learning disabilities. Children do very well in the young years of life. Okay, why? Because mom has been teaching him every day, you're 1, 2, 3, 1, 2. I'm getting, he's an 80, 90% doctor, abhi 60% ho gaya. Kaise ho sakta hai? You get it? So fun, straight away the poor child sitting there realizes that he's a disappointment to his parents. Okay, when you are expressing it because you're worried about his future, but you don't realize he's taking it as a disappointment. Okay, and yes, I've got learning disabilities. And I have managed with my basic intelligence to go through standard 2, 3, 4, but now 5, 6, 7, 8, I'm going to struggle. And that struggle is taken as a weakness, so I can't cope with it. So what happens? I start manifesting in other forms. I hate going to school. I don't want to sit the test. I won't write my exam papers. I defy the situation because I'm worried when I do badly, my mom will get upset and that will upset him more than anything else. Okay, so parental stress and pressure is huge. So it's lovely to have joint families and everything, but these are children. They need time to do it their own way and learn their own way and to be encouraged irrespective of their strengths and weaknesses. Physical examination, usually unusual to have any neurodeficits. You'll examine the child and the child will be absolutely normal neurologically. Classical is giveaway weakness. They'll walk, and suddenly they'll just buckle down while they're walking. And the mummy, see, dekho, aisa girta hai, din bhar aise girte rehta hai. You get it? That's classical. There's no neurological symptom where you suddenly buckle down and give way. None. You get it? So you have to have a knowledge or a base of what we are looking for before I can say this does not exist. Okay, so false sensory findings, bizarre movements, gait, and distractible. Very often you can tell the child, you know, now I'm putting you in front of the video. I need to see exactly what happens to you. I'm hoping it will come. And sure enough, 5 minutes later, it will come. You get it? He wants you to see it. He wants you to understand what he has, find my solution for what I have or whatever it is. It's asking for the help and it comes out. Whereas normally a seizure is not something that you can ever trigger like that. It comes on its own, it goes on its own, and nothing you do can make it stop other than if you medicate it. So how do we manage? It's obviously a team who works with these children. So you've got the psychiatrist and the neurologist. One out of us will be seeing the child and this. Then we'll have psychological assessments. If they need therapy in the form of occupational therapy or remedial education or whatever the deficit is, we work on them. School is very, very, very important because the child then feels very bad going back to school after this whole event is over and explained to them and all. And if necessary, sometimes medication for anxiety, for depression, etc., to help the child get out of the situation. So the aim is obviously there is no magical cure and there is no magic medicine over here. Okay, here is a treatment plan which happens, and depending on which is the factor which is most disturbing for that child, we focus on that more. So if his academics is really bad, after I've explained to mommy what is learning disability, why is it affecting his study, it's not his fault, you have to help him, he's very intelligent, you don't have to worry, long term wise he will achieve and get a job and do well in life, but school is going to be difficult for him, then I focus on remedial education, helping him to cope with his academics better. Okay, but you've got to explain what's the cause of it and what's going to happen. You can't give a false sense of making everything all right. So we do multiple approach of psychotherapies, psychiatric intervention if needed. Physical activity is something which is very good. Endorphins are released whenever you exercise. Endorphins are what makes you feel good with yourself. It's a neurotransmitter which makes your brain feel happy, makes your brain feel good. So it's very recommended that all children should do some degree of physical activity on a daily basis. If you need other therapeutic modalities, then we look into that. So now I've decided that this is a somatic condition. How do I deal with the parents? So the first thing you do is you never tell them that he's faking it. You never tell them that this is wrong, false, or not true, and he's doing it only for that. You say, listen, it's actually a true thing. The child truly believes he's got a problem. Okay? And invariably, one of the parents might have realized, you know, it's coming regularly, this, so one might be a little more easy to convince, but sometimes your parent, nahin, nahin, mera beta kabhi aisa nahin karega. Bilkul nahin kar sakta hai. So it's very tough. It's more difficult to deal with the parent than it is to deal with the child. So you have to first convince the parent that, listen, this is almost like a cry for help. This is a child telling you, mama, please sit with me and listen to me and see what my problems are. Don't, I don't know, expect or demand or whatever it is so much. Sometimes the child puts the pressure on himself. So you have a lot of these A-type personality children who always want to come first in class, who've always been coming first. They're best in sports, best in study, best in this, and this time he came second. And that second disturbed him so much that he just can't cope with that second position at all, and that's why this whole cycle has started. So you have to see the child's personality. You have to see the parent's personality. Very often a parent will say, listen, I'm cool. If he doesn't do, as long as he passes, I'm not worried. But the child, no, I have to come first, I have to. So you have to see who is really contributing to the situation. Regular routine visits. Once you've diagnosed it, you've counseled them, you've told them. You don't obviously add any more medication. If you can, you slowly withdraw all the drugs, because many children come to us on 4 and 5 anti-epileptic drugs. And you definitely don't want a child taking an anti-epileptic drug which works on your brain unless it's absolutely essential. So what I usually do, I do a placebo, I give a vitamin or I give a supplement. I tell the child, I'm giving you a medicine just for your problem. Don't you worry. And in 3 months, I'm sure this medicine will work beautifully and you'll be absolutely fine. Don't expect it to go overnight. He's gotten so used to doing it 6, 7, 8 times a day, it's not going to disappear. But slowly over a period of time, if the parent anxiety goes down, the child becomes much better. The main thing is the parent has to calm itself. How does the parent calm? Say, no problem, it doesn't matter if this happens. You just lie over there for 2 minutes. When it's finished, you get up and come to me in the kitchen. Doctor has told me you'll be fine. I'm not worried about it. So the child will do that event and he'll see mom doesn't come running anymore and mom doesn't pick him up and she doesn't throw water on him and she doesn't call daddy and grandpa and grandma and the whole building doesn't come to rush him to the hospital. Automatically realize it's not getting him what he wants and it slowly changes. Okay, so the shift attention away from the physical complaint and to current life issues. Long-term management, interrupting perpetual factors, try and maintain the same doctor, because you don't like what one says, you go to the next. You don't like what this one says, you go to the third. So you try to find the doctor who says the things you want to hear from him. very difficult at the end of the day. So try and maintain the same thing. Try and follow with your therapist or your psychologist. Okay, so very often after a few weeks, everything is settled and mom stops going because she thinks it's not needed. But it is an internal anxiety. It is an internal thing that the child may still be having. It doesn't disappear within a week or 2 weeks. So he needs someone to get it out with. He needs someone to talk to regularly and give him coping skills. How do I cope? I'm not doing well in school. Okay, I'm very fat and my friends are making fun of me. What do I do? I'm not good on the sports ground and I keep falling all the time and everyone is faster than me. How to help him with that? Okay, little things that you and I take for granted upsets them a lot. So coping skills, modulating the interaction of anxiety, stress and physical symptoms. So here I have two cases. I've taken the permission of both these children to show their videos. Both of them are relatively new. They happened virtually in the last 1 month. So it's not that atypical for us to see. Okay, it's not that rare either. So this is a 12-year-old boy who came to me with complaints of seizures since the last 9 months. Initially, he used to get one every 3 to 4 months. He consulted a pediatric neurologist and an EEG showed some epileptiform discharges. I don't know if you can see, but you have little discharges here in the right centrotemporal. Now, we have an epilepsy which comes classically in children from 8 to 12 years of age. It's a benign epilepsy. It comes once in 3 to 6 months. It comes at 8, 10 years, and it goes by 12 to 15 years of age. It's just benign. It comes and it goes, and we try as far as possible not to treat it if necessary, unless the frequency becomes very often. Because we know it's going to go in a few years. It doesn't do anything. It comes once in 6 months. Why give a child everyday medicine? But his EEG showed these discharges and he was started on some medication. He was not controlled with one medicine. Then another was added. And with time, the frequency kept increasing instead of decreasing. And more AEDs were added. Now I see that EEG and my mind tells me this is benign childhood Rolandic epilepsy. This child should not be having so many seizures. This child should have one in 3 months, one in 6 months. He's already 12 years. He should be growing out of it. In fact, it should become less and less instead of more and more. You get it? So automatically your mind is telling you something doesn't fit with the clinical picture and the EEG. Now he's getting 3 to 8 events a day. Okay, and that was his EEG that he had. He has absolutely no control and he's on 3 anti-epileptic drugs in high doses. His EEG done multiple times in between continues to show discharges, but every time the EEG, there was no event picked up. They've done an MRI on him, they've done bloods on him, they've done metabolic tests, they've done everything you can possibly on him. And now he started with complaints and this was only on sitting and asking him. Anything else happens? Yes, these headaches have started now. They keep coming regularly, these headaches. And I get this tingling only on one side of my leg, only on this side of my leg. I keep getting this tingling now. If it had been only tingling at one side and it had persisted, I wouldn't ignore it. I would look into it. But now when I have 3 things, you get it, which are not connecting to each other and are not fitting in with each other, my mind starts asking. So I start asking how many days of school has he missed and how many children do you have at home? Middle child syndrome. Classically, the middle child will have the maximum problems. Okay, because he feels neglected from the older one and the last one and the middle one feels that he's not getting mama's attention. So it's like he's asking for attention and all this happens. So you'll slowly start picking up things. And this was, how do I go to? Can you just put the video on for me? Okay, so this is, we do a video telemetry where we put you in the video. That's a seizure. Okay, so dad sits over there and he presses the button when the seizure starts. And according to, see, suddenly he was moving and he just becomes limp. His hands go down and his head goes to one side and his eyes are shut and dad is calling him from the side and nothing happens. And he doesn't respond and he doesn't respond at all. And we are talking to him and giving him instructions and he acts as if he can't hear anything. Then he starts drooling as well. Okay, so little saliva starts coming out, which is honestly the easiest thing you can ever do. Make saliva and make it come out from the side of your mouth. So this is how we test in a seizure. We give you an object, we give you a color, we give you things. So we check to see whether you remember it afterwards, to see whether your consciousness is there or not. We do the whole thing. We're talking to him. He's pinching him, giving him little stimulus. They're amazing. Even you poke them, pinch them, whatever, they don't move. Nothing happens. And that's mom very anxious at the side, not knowing what to do, how to break it. And then it's over. Okay? And it's over, and we did this for about 12 hours, and we got about 8 or 10 events in 12 hours, which is a hell of a lot. And the important thing for us is during that EEG, nothing happens. You get it? So we can see very clearly that there is no change on the EEG. The same activity continues. It's not like he's getting discharges, etc. And he's back to normal. And normally after a seizure, you feel sleepy and you fall asleep. Normally after a seizure, you have something. So we're looking for all the signs and symptoms, and we realize it's not happening. So his history reviewed at the time we saw, we actually saw an event in the clinic. That's why I said, let's do a video EEG during the recording. Events could be provoked. They said, come on, tell us, let's see what happens. And sure enough, we got one. And there was no simultaneous discharges. And what were the things that we had? Academics, this kid was a very good student. He was the topper in his class. He takes part in all extracurricular activity. He's very competitive by nature, but was refrained from all activities. Because of this anxiety, suddenly he stopped going and doing. Mom stopped him from all physical activity. No football, no cricket, no nothing that was happening. And emotionally, always wanted to come first. Very sensitive as a child. You could actually see it while he was sitting there. You know, when their eyes are so sharp and listening to every word that you're talking, because he's trying to pick up what is it he's got and what is his problem, etc. You know immediately that this child is very anxious. Only child of the parents, only child in that home with two sets of two brothers and sisters and the grandparents, and this is the only child in the whole house. Okay, and very anxious father. Father was just like, I almost felt I had to treat him more than I had to treat the child. Mom had got a clue as to what was happening. So what are the concerns? Different symptoms, too many doctor visits, repeated investigations happening, lots of drugs being given to this poor child, started missing school and activities and started dropping out in his social life, friends, everything starts going, got isolated from his peer group. And you know, once it starts, it's so tough. After 6 months, if I've sat at home to go back to my school, my gang, the secrets are different, the games are different, the gang has changed. He's become so good at this sport. I've lost all my skills in something else. You don't understand how important it is that children continue to go to school even through difficult phases so that they stay socialized with each other. Then what did we find? That his IQ, so I did a full neuropsych battery on him, okay, to see what it is, what was causing it. His IQ is roughly 105, which is an average IQ. His ADHD is okay, average. He wasn't really inattentive that much. He had distinct learning disabilities. He was very anxious by personality. He had depressive traits and he had mild attention problems. So now you understand why his academics are dropping. You get it? It's not like he's not trying. The kid is trying as hard as he was the year before, but his grades are beginning to drop and he just can't take it. Thematic, we did the tests and we found there was a great deal of somatization, attention seeking, anxiety, and intrinsic need for achievement. So these are things that you do with testing to be able to guide you. So what do? We do not dismiss the complaints ever. Please do not ever, ever, ever say you're faking it, ye sab jhoot kar raha hai. Never. Don't undermine the child's confidence at any stage ever. Or the parent for that matter, because no parent likes to be told, oh, your child is, you know, making this up. So you have to put it to them very gently and carefully, investigate appropriately, rule out an organic cause. You have to do that. So don't take it for granted that it's not something. Reassure the child, do placebo. When I give that vitamin, what am I doing? I'm giving a placebo, but I'm telling him it's a cure for his treatment. Reassure the parents and grandparents. Sometimes you have to write a letter to the school. You have to reassure the teachers that don't worry. Tell him to put his head down, but make him continue class after that. Otherwise, she calls the mom and says, please take him home immediately. You get it? It's very easy to just say, okay, I can't cope with the problem. Let the parent take it home. No, you have to help with the problem. You have to help the kid get out of the problem. So give him the reassurance, send him to the sick room, sit him down, take 5 minutes off, and let's go on again. Then automatically he realizes he's not getting what he wants. Stress on the importance of regular visits to the psychologist and to the therapist. So he came back to me yesterday, in fact. So he started on cognitive therapy, counseling session. Parents are relaxed. Both came in smiling. He's had, for the first 2 weeks, he had two events in that 2 weeks, from eight events in a day. And when he came yesterday, he hasn't had a single event since then. And I kept telling him, you're fine, are you all fine? He said, I've always been fine. So he says, I've always been fine, but dad is over there. And dad is like, oh, abhi wapas aayega to kya karun, abhi wapas aayega. I said, wapas nahi aane, I soch bhi mat aise. You get it? But I can imagine, if by chance he does another one tomorrow, dad is going to come rushing back again to me, dekho wapas aaya. So it takes time to make them understand that it's nothing to worry. Continue with counseling, parents also less anxious. This is an 18-year-old girl consulted in September with concerns of some paroxysmal events since the last 3 months, was admitted for the same, investigated in detail, no concerns other than hypothyroidism, EEG normal, MRI, started on seizure medicine. Yeah, can we start it? So this family came into the room, it was a mum and a daughter. And daughter looked just so apathetic, listless and uninterested in life. And she was supposed to have these events, and then the minute she went out of my clinic room in the outpatient sitting there, she had these events where she tightens herself, she shakes her fingers, she tightens her legs, her head goes to one side, her eyes look as if they're rolling up, it almost looks like they're rolling up, or they are rolling up to some extent. But one of the giveaways that she does is she hyperventilates. Hyperventilation is a very giveaway sign that I am, it's not natural, it's not really happening. So very often you'll have these young girls in stressful situations, they keep breathing and then they go and then they get hypocarbia and really feel lightheaded in the brain and then they have something that happens, okay? So this hyperventilation kept on, that gave it away. She had no benefit with multiple drugs, with behavior. She was on 4 or 5 drugs, epilepsy drugs, behavior drugs, mood medication. She continued to have these events, became very dull. Now, how much was the drug and how much was her underlying problem? We couldn't tell. She was not interested. Behavior changes were noted. No interactions with friends. She had stopped studying, consulted numerous doctors, consulted gynecologists. She was actually getting menstrual concerns, irregular menses as well. Did not sit for her 12th board exams, did not appear for 2 papers during the second attempts. Friends just saw her sitting over there and not writing a single word. She didn't come back and tell her mom this. However, eventually she did it and eventually cleared the CET and this. And this has been going on for some time. She lost her father to cancer the year before. And she was very attached to her father. Okay, and the parents, the grandparents sort of negate her importance in the family totally. She has a younger brother and she was the older sister. And everything is around this little younger brother who is like the king of the house. And she being the older sister is just not looked into or not important enough. Poor mom is a single mom trying to earn a living for the entire 5 people which are there after dad died. So she doesn't have the time to give this child the attention she's seeking. So I sat her down separately and I asked mom to go out. And she told me she just wants to leave home. She wants to start earning money so that she can leave home and live on her own. And her grandparents just don't care for her and they're all the time deriding her about it. And slowly it manifests. So this was her way of reaching out to her mom and saying, mom, look at me. You get it? That's all it was. And she was getting it. Her mom was taking her from doctor to doctor. Her mom was taking leave from work. Her mom was missing her earnings for it at the cost of her own anxiety. But this is how she was reaching out to the family for support. So here, her main concern were family dysfunction. It was not academic, it was not friends, it was not. And she eventually became depressed because of this. And touch wood, today she's doing much well. So how do we treat, consult, give adequate time and listen to the child and the parents' problems. Investigate appropriately always and rule out you're not looking at something organic, okay? And then refer to the next consult. So if there's gastro symptoms, I'm not the pro at gastro. I can't be guaranteed that her irritable bowel is not really an irritable bowel. So I have to send to the appropriate specialist. Counsel the adolescent, but more important, counsel the parents. And psychologists stress on the importance of regular visits. This is not something that goes in 2 weeks, 4 weeks, 2 months, 3 months. It takes time to get the mind to think positively, start again, and give the child the ability to cope. Most important, everyone has stressors. You and I get up some days and we feel so down and so depressed. Okay, this is part of the way your mind works on you. But how to cope with everyday's life stresses, that's where someone sometimes needs to give them help. So do not ever say the child is faking. Take this condition very seriously. Do not negate it ever. Address it like it is a call for help, as the child is not able to cope with the environment. And just the last take-home messages. Somatic illness results from psychological stress that is unconsciously expressed in a physical form. What are the risk factors? Adolescence, history of abuse or adverse childhood events, personality traits, and developmental concerns. The diagnosis should be based on the evidence from clinical exam, rule out organic causes, look at the different behavior and medically unexplained symptoms. You need to have a good doctor-patient relation. So find someone you're comfortable with and then stick with that doctor and keep going there and focus on management rather than cure. Thank you. So happy to take any questions. Yeah.
May I?
Yeah, sure.
No question, but a comment, Dr. Udwadia. First of all, a very excellent and insightful lecture over here.
Thank you.
But this clearly shows that our mind and body are connected. If we cannot express things which are going on in our mind, consciously or unconsciously, it is reflecting somewhere in our body. And it's up to the physician to interpret this as not being an illness of the body, but of the mind. And that's excellently demonstrated through the two videos over here. So with that, I would just request the audience to further probe you with the questions that they would have.
Thank you, ma'am, first of all. Ma'am, if they are on too many medications, like I have a patient, she is around 45, and she has marital discords and family dysfunctional. She has a dysfunctional family, and then she is on asthma, arthritis medication, and then she is taking many more medications. So how do we deal with that? Like, a lot of medications would be having their own side effects. So I went to the doctors she was consulting. I had a phone call with them, and they were like, "Nay, this is necessary, this is necessary, this is necessary." So a lot of medications going on, then psychological effects. So how do you deal with that, or what can be done on that?
Not easy at all. That's, I think, the syndrome also of having specialists. When you have too many specialists, everyone only looks at only their sphere. Whereas if you have a generalist, or your GP or your general physician looks at the patient as a whole, it becomes much easier. So each specialist is going to say, no, I need this, I need this, I need this. I would first focus on working on the well-being, mental well-being of that patient. So it's the same as migraine, it's the same as any of these things we treat. Something is going to be with you for a very long period of time. You've got to learn to cope with it. You can't keep chasing a solution for it. You've got to find ways within yourself to find the best you can be with that situation. So whether it's yoga or walking or meditation or whatever you want to do, try and find a feeling of wellness from within yourself. Calm the anxiety in the mind that she has, and then maybe you should be able to take down one or two of the medicines. Sometimes you can't take them down because the problems are so much. So then you need to have someone who can do drug-drug interaction and protect you from that. Because it's true, many drugs give you side effects, and it's only when you take it yourself that you realize, as a doctor, when you take it yourself, you realize how everyone reacts to a drug differently. So that you have to go back to your specialist and write and tell them, listen, she's feeling like this ever since this drug has started. Please help me adjust the dose. But preferably a generalist helps you in this when you have so many different system involvements.
One more question, please.
Oh. Ma'am, is it like that people with dependent personality disorder have more of somatic illness?
I really wouldn't be the best person to answer that. Would you be able to?
People with dependent personality disorder have more of somatic illness?
No.
No, there is no such data to say that a given personality. In fact, there is more likelihood that progressing, these people may actually land up with neurological problems ahead in life. So, of course, there could be some variables. And technically, before the age of 18, we don't speak about personality. We speak of temperamental traits in this particular children. And to my best of knowledge, there is no such thing that a dependent personality is more likely to come out with these kind of symptoms.
Right. Thank you, Dr. Udwadia, for interesting.
Just make a little bit of an addition to what. Yeah, hi. just making a bit of an addition there.
Just a bit. Sometimes the question that you've asked, you should also think that there are sometimes family circumstances, socio-cultural backgrounds that facilitate the development of dependent personality traits. And the same ones can increase the chances of conversion and emotional disorders happening. So families wherein a person is not allowed to think for themselves, make decisions, not able to express themselves, are at a greater likelihood of going on and developing dependent traits, not personality. But the same type of background will also increase the risk of emotional problems. So sometimes you may see them together, but like Dr. Ashutosh said, that there isn't a real evidence that it is going to be increased the risk by itself.